Guillermo del Toro's work is always a feast for the eyes. Specializing in sci-fi and fantasy, his filmography ranges from gothic romance to comic book movies, winning the Best Picture Oscar for The Shape of Water in 2018. With Pacific Rim, he combined blockbuster action with heartfelt storytelling and a keen eye for visual worldbuilding. The movie was inspired by two massively popular subgenres in Japanese sci-fi: kaiju movies like Godzilla and mecha anime, where humans pilot giant suits of robotic armor. Pacific Rim is also one of the most visually sumptuous Hollywood blockbusters of the 2010s, with gorgeous, thoughtful costumes. But what is it that makes those costumes so great?
All right, Mako, get ready, this is for real.
Hi there, I'm Gavia Baker-Whitelaw and this is Behind the Scenes, decoding the world of costume design.
You ready for this?
These days, blockbusters rely heavily on franchise branding. When a studio decides to spend hundreds of millions on a new standalone movie, it usually hinges on star power. This makes Pacific Rim a true rarity. It's an original film whose lead actors weren't very famous, and it's memorable enough to gain a cult following. This longevity is partly thanks to Del Toro's emphasis on sincere emotional storytelling, and partly thanks to his memorable visual style. Blockbusters tend to be pretty shallow. That isn't necessarily a problem, though. When we watch this kind of movie, we're not looking for an intellectual challenge. We just want to be entertained. That's why most blockbusters follow a familiar structure, with simple characters and a predictable blend of action, comedy, and drama. Of course, we occasionally see a truly excellent example, like Black Panther or Mad Max Fury Road. They feature multifaceted visual design and deeper narrative themes, but they can still be enjoyed on a very shallow level. Pacific Rim falls into this category. The concept is simple, an apocalyptic story where aliens invade Earth and humans fight back using robotic suits called Jaegers. Each Jaeger requires two pilots who share a psychic bond. Basically, they're soulmates. Pacific Rim is incredibly fun to watch, featuring delightfully silly moments, like a giant robot wielding a sword. But there's also a lot going on under the surface. Del Toro is a lifelong fan of monster movies and began his career as a makeup and special effects artist. His projects often originate with handwritten notes and self-drawn concept art. Pacific Rim's Japanese influences are most obvious in the design of the kaiju and Jaegers, but the overall aesthetic is fully Del Toro, overlapping with his other movies. Don't get me wrong, this isn't all on him. Filmmaking is collaborative, and Del Toro works with a team of artists who share his sensibilities. In this case, he met costume designer Kate Hawley while they were both working on an early draft of the Hobbit trilogy before Peter Jackson took over the project. She went on to design the costumes for Crimson Peak, a very different type of film.
That's sad.
No, it's not sad, Edith. It's nature.
Then we have production designers Andrew Nesgaromny, who mostly works on monster movies, and Carol Spear. You probably don't know her name, but she's worked on a legendary run of horror movies by both Del Toro and David Cronenberg. Del Toro also wrote detailed backstories for each character, fleshing out the original script by Travis Beecham. This fed into the actors' performances and the complexity of their styling choices. So, much of the story is told through visual cues that we might not even know we're absorbing. Pacific Rim's setting lays the groundwork for its overall aesthetic. Set in an alternate version of the year 2020, kaiju have been attacking humankind for years. Jaegers are the only weapon to successfully defeat them, but world governments want to focus on building giant walls instead. Needless to say, this works as an allegory for various real-life issues. While the main characters are high-tech action heroes, they still feel like scrappy underdogs. And Pacific Rim lacks the authoritarian subtext we see in many other Hollywood blockbusters. The main characters are a diverse group whose strength lies in teamwork and emotional vulnerability. In an interview with The Star, Del Toro said, "I carefully avoided the car commercial aesthetics or the army recruitment video aesthetics. I avoided making a movie about an army with ranks." People in the Jaeger program have titles like Marshal or Ranger, echoing the Wild West instead of the military.
Marshal!
Sir, we've hit the breach before. It doesn't work. Nothing goes through. What's changed?
I've got a plan. I need you ready. That's all.
Likewise, the brilliance of Pacific Rim's costume design lies in its lack of uniformity. Every costume reflects the character's personalities, even the anime-inspired armor worn by the Jaeger pilots, which differs from team to team. In a previous episode, I discussed the trend of action movies using an intentionally dull, grey color palette. Del Toro would never do this. He wants his movies to look beautiful, and in this case, he also wanted to avoid the idea of a uniformed military force. He portrays an environment where people are allowed to express themselves and look different, celebrating their different backgrounds and outlooks while still working together.
Who is that, Yamarashi?
Oh, this little kaiju? Yeah, you got a good eye.
My brother and I took him down in 2017.
Pacific Rim also includes numerous unspoken details that add dimension to the film's world. For instance, there's a cult that worships the kaiju as gods. Some other people build shantytowns called bone slums, located in the remains of dead kaiju. And throughout the film, there's a recurring motif of kaiju blue, a vibrant color inspired by bioluminescent kaiju flesh. Above all, Del Toro definitely wants his characters to stand out. Our two leads are Raleigh Beckett, played by Charlie Hunnam, and Mako Mori, played by Rinko Kikuchi. Both characters were shaped by the kaiju invasion. Mako lost her parents and was adopted by Idris Elba's character Stacker Pentecost, a commander in the Jaeger program. Meanwhile, Raleigh piloted an old Jaeger alongside his brother, who died in battle. At the start of the film, Raleigh is depressed and working construction jobs. He doesn't care about his appearance, and his costume suggests that he's living a rough life. In the old days, his whole identity was wrapped up in his job as a Jaeger pilot. He and his brother wore matching bomber jackets in a callback to 1940s wartime style. Meanwhile, Mako grew up in the Jaeger program, raised by a strict father figure. Her costumes combine neatness and practicality with a clear sense of style, beginning with a very chic introductory scene.
She's one of a kind now.
She always was.
Originating from one of Del Toro's own sketches, this outfit includes combat boots and tough, durable fabrics. But the silhouette is tailored and stylish, echoing designers like Rick Owens and Yoji Yamamoto. It's typical for female characters to wear more interesting clothes than their male counterparts. But this isn't actually the case in Pacific Rim. Raleigh may be pretty low-key, but there's a lot of variety among the other men. As I said earlier, Pacific Rim uses plenty of familiar blockbuster tropes. So among our main cast, we have several stock characters. The stern commander, the mad scientists, the tech guy, and a couple of macho jocks. We also get a truly iconic supporting role for Ron Perlman, playing the gangster Hannibal Chow. Between Ron Perlman's swagger and his outlandish costume, you barely need to know anything about the character for him to have an impact.
Now get the hell out of here.
Stacker Pentecost is at the opposite end of the scale. In most movies, we'd barely notice his costume, but in Pacific Rim, his uniform feels like a meaningful choice. He's the only character who wears this kind of military outfit, So we can interpret this as his own form of self-expression. He's the backbone of the Jaeger program, but he's hiding a serious illness. His obsessively neat appearance is a sign of rigid self-control, emphasizing his powerful physique and avoiding any sign of weakness. Then we have Dr. Geisler and Dr. Gottlieb. They're a couple of stereotypical mad scientists, providing exposition and comic relief with an odd couple dynamic.
That's impossible.
Is that impossible?
It's impossible. Because...
You know what? Why don't you come for the Kaiju?
You! Shut up!
Newt Geisler is a Kaiju-obsessed biologist with an overblown ego. He thinks he's a rock star and dresses to match with extensive tattoos and a leather jacket. But obviously, he's still a huge nerd. Meanwhile, Hermann Gottlieb is the exact opposite, a curmudgeonly academic who dresses like he's about 90 years old. He thinks of himself as the serious half of this partnership, when in fact, he's just as hysterical as Newt.
Politics and poetry, promises, these are lies. Numbers are as close as we get to the handwriting of God. What? Would you give me a moment?
These two characters come as a pair, and their style is dialed up to 11, giving us an immediate visual guide to their contrasting personalities. Pacific Rim also includes numerous background characters with conspicuous outfits. Even without distinct personalities or dialogue, we latch on to these characters because they look memorable. This attention to detail is a recurring strength among blockbusters that stand the test of time. Star Wars is the best example, showcasing an incredible range of props and costumes for tiny, unimportant characters. You could say the same of The Matrix or The Fifth Element. While Pacific Rim got pretty good reviews, it wasn't a box office hit in the US. It was much more popular overseas. Sometimes this happens when a film just doesn't land with a particular audience, but often it's down to clumsy marketing. If you look at the trailers for Pacific Rim, they focus heavily on action over style or character, giving the impression that it's an off-brand version of the Transformers franchise. But really, Pacific Rim is closer to Star Wars, a franchise whose longevity relies on strong emotional storytelling and visual panache. The action scenes are great, but Pacific Rim's view of heroism is different from most Hollywood blockbusters, with a lot more emphasis on healing and collaboration. And on an aesthetic level, this wasn't just another big budget disaster movie. It was a Del Toro movie, which really counts as a brand unto itself.
Are you okay? Do you copy?
Thanks so much for watching Behind the Scenes. What's your favourite big budget blockbuster? And are you just in it for the popcorn? Or is there more going on behind those explosions? Share your picks in the comments below. And if you enjoyed this video, give it a like and subscribe to our channel for future episodes. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.